In this video, we're going to look at an introduction to molecular orbital theory. Now, MO theory involves some very, very complicated quantum math, and I'm going to completely ignore the math, and we're just going to try to think about it as simply as possible using pictures. So when we did mechanisms, we thought about electrons as being particles, but we can also think about them as being waves. And we know that electrons are found in highest probability in what we call atomic orbitals. When atoms combine to form molecules, those atomic orbitals actually recombine to form what we call molecular orbitals. Combining atomic orbitals together is just like combining waves together. And so we're going to start off with a very simple way of thinking about waves. We could even think about waves like waves in the ocean. So if I think about this horizontal line here as being like the average level of my ocean, I could go ahead and draw a wave there. And so I have part of the wave above the average level of the ocean. I'm going to call that a phase, and I'm going to make that the red phase like that. And then part of the wave is below the average level of the ocean, so I'm going to make that the blue phase. So there's one wave. If I were to combine that wave with another wave that looks exactly the same, so we're just going to pretend here that those two waves are identical. All right, this would be red, and then this part would be blue. Right here, if I were to combine those two waves, there are a couple ways to do it, right? You could think about superimposing these two waves on top of each other. And one way to think about that would be to think about vectors. So if I thought about a vector here for the top wave, if you've taken a physics class, you understand everything there is to know about vectors. So here's one vector. And then this vector down here would be going in the same direction and the same length. If I were to superimpose these two waves on top of each other, these two vectors would add to each other, right? So those two vectors would add. And so we would get an even bigger wave over here on the right. So those two vectors are going to add together like that. The same thing happens with the phases in blue. This vector would be pointing down this time, and this vector would also be pointing down. But if you added those two waves together, if you superimpose them on top of each other, those two vectors would add like that, and you would get an even bigger part over here like that. So that would be the product of adding those two waves together. They add constructively, right? So over here, this would be where our two red phases added together, and this would be where our two blue phases added together. So we get constructive overlap. So let me go ahead and write that. This is constructive overlap. And so this is when we added our waves in phase. So we combine these two waves in phase, which means that the colors matched up, right? We combine the two red colors together, and we combine the two blue phases together, and that gave us constructive overlap. Let's do another example of adding waves, another very simple one. So we're going to start with, once again, a wave that has part of it above the average level of the ocean, like that. And then this part is going to be below. This time, though, we're going to add to something that's pretty much the opposite. So we're going to start below the average level of the ocean and finish above, like that. So let me go ahead and make this one blue now. And then this one right over here is red. And so we're going to add these two waves together. Once again, vectors help me think about it. And so if I think about this first wave, this vector will be going that way. And then for the second wave down here, the vector will be going the opposite direction. Okay, so when I add those two vectors together, or when I superimpose those two waves, the vectors would cancel each other, and you would get destructive overlap. So pretty much you get nothing over here on the right. So this would be destructive overlap. Those two vectors cancel each other out. And the exact same thing happens when we try to combine this part of the wave with this part of the wave, right? Those two vectors would cancel each other out in space. We get destructive overlap. And so we tried to combine these two waves out of phase, meaning we tried to combine the red with the blue both times. And so since we were combining out of phase, the vectors cancel and give us destructive overlap. And so this is just, again, a very simple way of thinking about waves. The nice thing about it is when we combine atomic orbitals, we can think about the same thing. We can combine atomic orbitals either in phase or out of phase. So let's go ahead and do that. Let's combine some atomic orbitals, and we're going to do so for the simplest atom, which is of course hydrogen. So if I take hydrogen, right, with its one valence electron, I know that that one valence electron occupies an atomic orbital, that's shaped like a sphere, right? So if I were to draw that spherically shaped atomic orbital, And I know that hydrogen has a nucleus, and I know the most common isotope has only one proton in the nucleus, so that's going to represent the nucleus of hydrogen, and then the sphere around it is the atomic orbital of hydrogen, like that. So I'm going to combine that hydrogen atom with another hydrogen atom. So once again, I'm going to think about a nucleus for the hydrogen atom, and then that a one valence electron occupies an s orbital, which is shaped like a sphere. All right, let's go ahead and draw this again down here. So I'm going to have the nucleus, and I'm going to have the s orbital. So I'm going to do the same thing over here, like that. Now, when I combine my two atomic orbitals together, I know that I can combine them in phase and out of phase. So let's go ahead and write that. In the top example, we're going to combine in phase, and the bottom example, we're going to combine out of phase. So let's go ahead and put some colors on here. So if I'm going to combine the first two atomic orbitals in phase, I need to make them the same color. So I'm going to make these guys both red, like that. So they're going to combine in phase. And then down here, I'm going to combine out of phase. So I'm going to use different colors. So this is going to be red, and then this one is going to be blue, like that. Okay, so I know when I combined two waves in phase, I got constructive overlap. And so here when I combine my two atomic orbitals for hydrogen in phase, I'm going to get constructive overlap. So let's go ahead and draw the molecular orbital that is produced. So here is one nucleus, and here is another nucleus. Those two atomic orbitals are going to recombine, cease to exist. They're going to produce a molecular orbital, an orbital associated with the entire hydrogen molecule. So here I have sketched in my molecular orbital over here on the right. And so this combined in phase, it was constructive overlap, and so this is the molecular orbital that results. The atomic orbitals have ceased to exist. They have produced a molecular orbital like that. And so if I were to draw the dot structure of what just happened, right, you could think about, you know, this electron is being shared with this atom, and this electron is being shared with that atom to produce a covalent bond between those two hydrogen atoms like that. And so this is the molecular orbital that results, that is produced as a result of constructive overlap. Again, the atomic orbitals cease to exist. We've produced a molecular orbital. And this is a bonding molecular orbital. So this is a bonding molecular orbital. We know that because the electrons are shared between the two nuclei. And so the delocalization, the sharing of these electrons, lowers the energy of the hydrogen molecule. And so a bonding molecular orbital is lower in energy, right? It's constructive overlap. If we look at down here, where we try to combine our two atomic orbitals of hydrogen out of phase, right? When we try to do that, we get destructive overlap. And so when we get destructive overlap, there is no sharing of electrons between our two nuclei, and so we produce what's called a nodal plane between the two nuclei. There's no electron density between the two nuclei. So if I were to just draw in my molecular orbitals, right, something like this is what you see in most textbooks, right? So over here on the left, I'm going to say this is our red phase, and over here on the right is the blue phase. So when you try to combine atomic orbitals out of phase, you produce a molecular orbital, but there's no electron density between those two nuclei, so really there's no bond, and so we call this an anti-bonding molecular orbital. So let me go ahead and do that in yellow here. So this is an anti-bonding molecular orbital. So destructive overlap means there's no electron density between the two nuclei. Therefore, those two positive charges are exposed to each other. And we know like charges repel. And so it's a lot like trying to put two magnets together that are the same pole, right? They're going to repel. So it would take a lot of energy to hold those two positive charges together. And so that's how I like to think about the fact that an anti-bonding molecular orbital is much higher in energy than a bonding molecular orbital, right? You would have to hold those two nuclei together, those two positive charges together. And so what we see here is when you combine two atomic orbitals together, you produce one bonding molecular orbital and one anti-bonding molecular orbital. So two atomic orbitals combine to form a total of two molecular orbitals. The bonding molecular orbital is lower in energy. The anti-bonding molecular orbital is higher in energy. And so we could represent that really quickly on an energy diagram. So if I were to show, here's an energy diagram right here, like that. So here's energy. And here are this energy level represents our atomic orbitals, right? So there's one hydrogen atom with one electron, and there's another hydrogen atom with another electron. And when those two atomic orbitals combine, they form two molecular orbitals. So they form two molecular orbitals. So there's a molecular orbital, and then here's another molecular orbital, like that. So two atomic orbitals combine to produce two molecular orbitals. The one that's lower in energy, we said, is our bonding molecular orbital. So there's our bonding molecular orbital. The one that's higher in energy is, of course, the anti-bonding molecular orbital. Like that. So this is our anti-bonding molecular orbital, and this is our bonding molecular orbital. Now, when these two electrons, right, so these are our electrons from our atomic orbitals, combine, they're going to fill, of course, the bonding molecular orbital since it's lower in energy. And so this is analogous to electron configurations, right? So electrons are going to fill the lowest energy orbital available, and we're also going to pair up the spins, right? So we're going to pair up those two spins. So those two electrons in a hydrogen atom prefer to occupy the bonding molecular orbital because it's lower in energy, right? So the anti-bonding molecular orbital does not have any electrons for this example. And of course, it is possible to give an electron in a bonding molecular orbital enough energy where it could jump up to the anti-bonding molecular orbital. And that would, of course, break the bond between the hydrogen between the two hydrogen atoms here. So this hopefully this video is a nice introduction to the concept of molecular orbital theory. We're going to use this concept a few more times in to develop more complicated topics of organic chemistry.